Okay, so it says Trevor Bull, chairman, it's a job I never wanted. I took over this role 3 months ago, sadly our chairman passed away. I wasn't on the board. I could tell the previous chairman behind the scenes a little bit with sort of thinking time, that sort of thing. But he passed away and suddenly I was thrust to the front and everyone was looking at me and I better do it then. So a testament to what Dave did before me was that it took 3 of us to replace him, because the deal was I had 2 guys to come and help me with it, otherwise I didn't feel I could do it on my own, so that's a task. So where did it all start off? Or where did it all go wrong? Where did we start? Well, that's where we started. In fact, when I started, that didn't quite look like that. That stand wasn't there, that stand wasn't there, that was a little wooden shack. That top of that was just part of the site. It was a great stadium, a great town. I started there in 1967. And the first game I went to, I stood, this was all open terrace in it, and we won 9-1. Oh, this is going to be fantastic. And I went 2 years later and it was nil-nil. So, hey ho. So yeah, so a wonderful place. And then that fateful summer of 2007, and some of you have been through this, is I spent the whole summer, as hundreds of people did in the town, waiting for news updates, listening to the radio, watching for the newspaper coming through the door, because we thought we were going to lose our club. We played our last game at Hucknall Town at the end of April, but we won 1-0, we didn't win many games that year. But then the summer. And devastation took over, and it soon ended up like that. I don't know how your ground, if you went through the same heartbreak, yes, seen it go like that. Yeah. And that's really hard, because I've got so many memories of my time in that stadium. So many happy memories. Some pretty rubbish ones when Jimmy Glass scored that goal against for Carlisle in the 100th minute or whatever it was. So yeah, so that's where it was. Now, before we came to that stage, the Supporters Trust started. I think it was in 2007. I can't remember the day, but it was before. I wasn't really involved at that time, but it was around the sort of early part of that year, because there was a worry around the town that things weren't right, and there were a lot of passionate people. That final season, our average crowd was 901. And in my entire football watching career, that's the lowest average crowd we've ever had. So we can see that things didn't go great. So we've had 10 years of highs and lows since then. You'll be familiar with some of these. Brilliant in town. In that summer of 2007, Supporters Trust decided that we would form a club, but we'd have to find somewhere to play. Bridlington is about 20 miles down the coast from us. Reasonable little ground. We held a meeting in the St Nicholas Hotel, and the chairman of Bridlington Town, and he still is the chairman, Peter Smurfley, came along. And he walked into the room, and when it was his turn to speak, he realised that the number of people in that room was double his average crowd on a Saturday. So I think he saw a money making opportunity. But fair play, over the last 10 years, he has been absolutely brilliant. Humbenby, some of you may know, little village just outside Scarborough, famous for the fact that you used to have about 20 pubs in Humbenby, but little village. At the start of pre-season training, our first appointed manager, Brian Franz, and his son, Darren, got all the players together in Humbenby for a training stroke practice match against one of the local Scarborough District League teams. There was more people turned out to watch that in the rain than any other league crowd in the North East Counties League that year. Just to come and see what was happening. Tennyson, that was our first ever league game. Now, what do you do if you're on a football club? You turn up in a business suit and a shirt and tie, don't you, if you're on the football club? So, 25% of our fans turned up at Terrace that day in business suits and smartly dressed. Lots of cigars happened. That sort of thing. But it was a super day. Tom Hill scored our first ever goal. The result wasn't the one we wanted, we ended up losing 2-1, but hey, you know, all of a sudden a little sleepy village in Nottinghamshire, we took about 400 fans down there, so they made a bit of money as well. Wordsworth Bridge of that season, this is probably my favourite story of that year. We visited Wordsworth Bridge, it's a little tiny village outside Barnsley. Lovely little ground by the river. We know it's by the river because there's a man with a big net behind the main stand. I'll say main stand, it's got three chairs and a shed. But the little man that sits by the river with a massive fishing net picking all the balls out of the river. And the week before we went there, or a few weeks before we went there, it was that year when we had the bad floods. So the ground had been this deep in water, the clubhouse had been ruined, real old state. Their previous home game, their attendance was 12. And on that particular day, we took 300 fans with us. So their chairman wrote to us the week after and said, because we bought pies, bought programmes, raffle tickets, and a lot of beer, he had enough money to run his club the rest of the season. Yeah. So we felt quite warm that we were getting around and doing a bit of good in that league we were in, because of course we got put right as far down as the football authorities could put us. Unless they put us in the Sunday League, we couldn't actually go any lower. And of course, when we were on this journey around the little clubs, we just got first team, and we were going to some villages that had got fully established semi-professional football clubs. They'd got youth teams, reserves teams, under-19 teams. It was incredible. A little town like Austin with two football clubs, and a town like Scarborough that didn't even have a ground. It was heartbreaking, but warming in a different way as well. Biddeford, where our best couple we went in the bars. Now, does anybody know where Biddeford is? It's a hell of a long way away. We took around 500 fans to Biddeford. When you think about the level that we're playing at now, that was incredible. A load flew down. I personally drove down, and I got there at about 12 o'clock, checked into a hotel, asked the hotel where the nearest pub was, and it's always that one down the quayside, and you couldn't get in for Scarborough House. So we had a great day, we were lovely. So we were happy that we got the following, we retained the passion. So we were averaging 500 probably for home games, 20 miles down the road, so we were quite pleased with that. And then there we became Division 1 champions the year after. It took us 2 years to get out to that first league. No great celebrations. Great season, really. We had a series of games, I think it was about five, where we won every game 6-1. Even if the other team first scored first, we just knew we'd win 6-1. We were just that confident. And then we suffered some tragedy. Brian France, my manager here, he got hit on the head with the ball on the touchline. Knocked himself out. Got a bit giddy, went home that night, another giddy fell down the stairs, top and bottom, a few months later he passed away, so that was a real struggle, difficult time for us. Then our chairman passed away very shortly afterwards, Richard Adamson. He'd really driven the club forward, so he was a tremendous loss. And then we became Premier Division champions. Wow, what a year that was. That was 2013. we It ended up as a two-horse race between ourselves and Brickhouse. And in that penultimate game of the season, we were away at Brickhouse. And I don't know if any of you have been to Brickhouse, but it's not the most salubrious of grounds. Very, very friendly. Very, very friendly. Lovely people. But effectively, we went there and we won it, but we took 800 fans to Brickhouse that day, which they'd never seen. It was then, it still is their record ever crowd. It ended up over 1,000. So it was a brilliant season. Then the football authorities, in their wisdom, decided that Scarborough was really a southern club. That year, I looked at the map of the Northern Premier League in total, not just the first division, but the Premier Division and the North and South. There was only one club geographically further north than us, but they put us in the south, so we were travelling down to Birmingham every other week, and awful time. We had an okay season, finished just outside the playoffs, but it was an awful lot of travelling. And then we came back into the north, which we felt was more our natural home, because we sort of knew the names of some of the places we were going to come and play, like Darlington. Yes, yes. Yeah, we knew where you were. And then Dave died a few months ago, which hit us all very hard. He worked exceptionally hard for 6 years to get the club back to Scarborough, and then 3 months before it happened, sadly brain hemorrhage and he's gone. He's doubly hard because his partner was Wendy, she was our secretary, so it hit the club very hard. And then we reached the playoffs last year, this year. We went on a 10-game unbeaten run at the end of the season to get in the playoffs. I think we only conceded one goal in those 10 games as well, so absolutely incredible. I'd love to claim some credit, but I took over, we never lost a game until the playoffs. But what that did for us, it showed the level of support that we could generate. So from overnight, our average crowd last season was about just under 400. And we had just over 1,000 come through to Bridlington for that final game, and also didn't bring many. So it was a great night, very exciting. I guess that's helping me sell the club to the town of Scarborough now we're going back, because it created a lot of interest at the end of the season. The previous season, we did a run through for the League Cup final, and we had a big night out at Farsley Celtic. But no, the playoffs were a good thing for us. Then football's coming home. This is a drawing of the new facility that when they start to paint that dream of what you're going to get, you're never really quite sure if it's going to become reality. it's a community stadium. We've got a large swimming pool and sports hall here, gyms and torture chambers, all that sort of thing. This area here is the football clubhouse. The stands, there's 250 seats in front of that, and then the changing rooms underneath. And then the south stand there with about 350, you can get in there. Quite a simple ground, 3G, which is great, because we've gone from not having any other than the first team. We've got a super junior setup now from under 10s through to under 17s. We had to pull out of the under 19 league this year, because I took over in beginning of April, and the league told me that you've still got 9 games to fulfill. Well, we've been trying to arrange them, so the league that they were in came up with this fantastic idea. They said, right, we've solved the fixture problem, you're going to play the same team twice on the same day. Right, okay. And then you're going to play 30 minutes each way. That's not proper football. You can keep your league. So we wibbled out a bit. So we'll get it back. But we never thought it'd be 10 years. 2007, with all that happened, I went to Bridlington. We were only going to the North End for 2 or 3 years. And we were back in Scarborough. All we needed was someone to give us a field, and we could have been up and running. So 10 years, a long 10 years. I'm now in a position where me, I, the club, the board, we need Scarborough's fullback in the football. The town has missed it, but they've got out of the habit. Oops, sorry. They've got out of the habit. We've got a lost generation that have never seen a live football match. They've seen TV football, and that's it for 10 years. So I've got to get them interested. So we've got a pre-season programme to create some interest. I think we mentioned earlier that we're playing Sheffield United on the 15th of July. 2,000 tickets sold out. We're going to play a charity match against Bridlington in memory of our late chairman on the Tuesday after that for people that couldn't get into the first game to get a second chance. We've got Leeds United sending a 23 side. Nick's got his laptop open.
Yeah, sorry, I'm doing the online.
The tickets went on sale online.
It's not right.
he's just trying to work out if he's making any money from it now. So we're seeing a lot of interest. We rely very heavily on sponsorship because we don't have any big benefactors. It's just what we can earn ourselves, what Nick can earn in sponsorship and commercial activity. And the message I'm trying to give to the people of Scarborough is, if you want a good football team, you've got to come through the Game Watchers. Mm-hmm. Because there's a direct correlation mm-hmm. between how many people come through those gates and the quality of the players that I can put on the pitch. Mm-hmm. At the moment, what my fans, our fans can't understand is why we're not signing all these big name players. Because you move back to town, you're going to get bigger crowds, it's going to be easy. No. Because our expenses have gone through the roof. Because all of a sudden, although it's a community stadium, and to be fair, the rent's very favourable to us, it's all the on-cost stewarding. We've had to appoint a safety officer. North Yorkshire County Council are very strict, much stricter than any other authority I've come across. The licensing laws are different. We've got so many restrictions. So our expenses are going through the roof. So I've had to say to our manager this year, you can have the same budget as last year. Because the on-cost. Now, if we have to be realistic around our forecast for crowds. If we get to end of October and there are 500 more than we budgeted for, then he can have a bit more money. But he's got to start winning games and getting the crowds in. So that's the basic layout of the ground. The red bits, those bits are there. Now, can I ask you a very serious question, so there's a reason for this. How many ladies' toilets have you got in your ground?
One in Kent for the people outside, and then if you remember the quick look, there's one downstairs.
So is that like, I'm talking cubicles?
Yeah. Oh, right, I've not been in.
I've not been in the ladies.
I bet you've been in.
I have.
Please,
one, two, three, four, five, six, one, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8, 8,
Changes underneath, I say, and then there's a nice big bar area and boardroom above it, so it's really very nice. These are steep grass banks up to the sports centre, and there's a wooden fence all around. There's always something that you don't expect. We've got the facilities to segregate here, there's a gate here and there's a strange fence in that stand here. So there's room at this end to put a separate burger van in. There are separate toilets, which is great. So you can imagine my horror when I went to the ground at the weekend and thought, you might have to walk around the ground. So I could you walk around the ground? And they put a fence here. So what's that for? Segregation. It's a permanent fence, which is that high. Well, in football terms, that's not really segregation. So when I looked at the way that the FA calculate capacity, I've got some more drawings that tell you how many people should be in each section of the ground. From that gate there to there, where the segregation is, I mean, if we get Darlington down and we have to segregate, you'd be naughty sometimes, you Darlington boys. We'd have to give you a third of our capacity. Well, that's not going to happen. Mm-hmm. So it's just a nonsense. I'm getting that sorted out. So what have we got in the way of room for expansion? Well, the ground already isn't big enough. So we haven't played the game yet, but we, Nixwood can't be me, decided it's not big enough. Not so much capacity-wise, because for the majority of games that should be okay. But I can't get my average crowd under cover. And given the climate in Scarborough, I don't think that's very wise. So I've had an architect down there this week looking to put some cover from here to that corner. The other thing I can't do is if there's any wheelchairs at ground level, I can't get them under any cover either, so I need to sort that out. Don't know how much it's going to cost. We've got an architect doing some drawings, we'll see where we come with that. Because if our fans come once and get soaking wet, look out the window, it's raining, they're not going to come again. Mm. So I'm trying to do something quite quickly to keep that in before the winter starts. Mm-hmm. But if it costs too much money, I won't be able to afford to do it. The drawn here, room for expansion, I've been looking at these kit stands, smaller than that one out there. But of course, you've got to be minimum 4 rows deep, not yet for league play. There's only room for 3 rows there. So I've got to find them. Now, in the master plan going forward, if I can cover that end, that's flat. All this, all the way around here, that's all flat tarmac. If I can get some terrace in there, I can get 4 steps there, so that increases the capacity a little bit. The room for expansion part of the programme is these two steep grass banks here. They're telling me that either side of the existing stand, you could get another 500 seats. Or on each side of the terrace, 1,000. I can't afford to do that. I can afford to go and maybe put a little standard like that, but that's a major construction job. The light at the end of the tunnel for us is that tenders closed a couple of days ago for the ground naming rights. And that could be worth a lot of money, but it's not my money, because the council have retained, who own the ground, have retained the naming right. However, if you review the tender document closely, and I talked to the Chief Executive of Scarborough Council the other day at the opening, is they're going to ring fence that in the council budget to spend on future ground improvements. Mm-hmm. The Chief Executive, talking about Scottish football, he's a big Air United fan, so he knows how things are difficult at this sort of level. We had a ground grading committee through, and we're a little Northern Premier League, but we've got to have a players tunnel. So, luckily, I've been out and I've found a sponsor that's going to pay for that for us, because we put his logo all over and everything else. So there's ways of doing things, but well, you know what it's like. There's always something coming out of the woodwork that's going to cost you money, cost you time, cost you effort, and create some problems for you. But in overall terms, what we've got is something much, much better than I'd dare dream of 10 years ago. So it is a fantastic facility. It's 3D pitch, so we've done a deal where every single one of our junior teams is going to be playing in that stadium. And they're training every night in the stadium. So we've got juniors training there from 5:30 till 7:00, 5 nights a week. And on a Sunday, from 10:00 till 5:00, I think it is, they're playing all their junior games, matches on the Sunday as well. So it's great that we can bring the whole club together. With regards to, I talked about, we've lost our under-19s team. What we decided to do is we've got under-17 this year. Next year they'll be under-18s, but we're going to grow it organically, mm-hmm. rather than just going out there to try and grab something. I don't know what it's like in your areas, but we've got a lot of academies, private academies setting up, and soccer schools and all this sort of thing, and they're trying to suck all the best players anyway, so we're going to try and grow our own. That's no idea, we haven't got a name yet. At the moment it's the Scarborough Sports Village, which doesn't really roll off the tongue. So challenges ahead. Finances. That's the big one. That'll always be a problem. Nick always puts his head down when I talk about finance, because he's the guy that, I'll be very honest, and I've said this publicly on a couple of occasions recently, but if it wasn't for Nick, we wouldn't have a football club now. He's just an absolute beast as far as a commercial director. He's fantastic. 12 months ago, we got ourselves in a real problematic situation, and we had to go cap in hand to our owners, our fans, and to raise £35,000 in 6 weeks. But we did it. We saved the club, because we could have gone under last year. Within sight of coming home, we could have gone under. So we just sort of limped over the line. But this year, we're in a much healthier position. The ground, as I say, it's not quite big enough, but we've got plans. We're gonna get there with it. The Lost Generation I've talked about. I started going in 1967, as I say, I was 9 years old. I was 9 years old. But you wouldn't put a kid on a bus to Bridlington at 9 years old and send them to go and watch football. One of the things that we're doing Kids Go, we've got a local company sponsoring Kids Go Free, so everyone under 11 years old comes to the ground for free with a paying adult. So we've given out loads of kids passes. We had an open day on Saturday. How many did you give away, Nick?
Just over 300.
Just over 300 passes. So that's getting the generation that we've lost. Volunteers. Does anybody here struggle for volunteers? I'm on a mission to try and make the club much more professional. So we are paying for more. We don't have any paid employees, but we're going to pay for proper stewarding for the first time. We're going to pay a safety officer for the first time. So some of the risk jobs that I don't really want on my watch, I'm going to pay someone else to do it. It just makes sense, because one of the things that I noticed at the end of last season when I first took this role on is my match day experience went right out the window. I've spent 10 years planning which 10 pubs I was going to go into on my way to a game, and now I'm going to have to be at the ground at 12:00. So me and my fellow directors decided that wait till the game's finished and we're going right on it. But volunteers is always a thing. We've only ever operated one or possibly two turnstiles at Bridlington. We've got 9 now. We're not going to man them for every game, but we need potentially 9 people to do that. We've got the way the ground's configured, we're going to need people to manage the car park. There's just always lots of things to do, and that's besides the all the weekday activities that go on in a football club outside of match day, because without those being right, the If you haven't got the secretary that can do a good job, you're in a real old pickle. Just put Winnie Matches on, I thought that was quite important as well. Because that'll keep the momentum and keep the income streams coming in. What has helped us is because we've got a new ground and the potential of a bigger crowd, it's helping us attract players. So because players want to play for bigger crowds, because the thing that I'm finding just unbelievable is how a player will leave us and go play for someone down the road for a fiver. It's the reverse of your bunch, aren't they? Giving Scarborough a team to be proud of, yeah, because we've got a rich history. In my football watching lifetime, in the 70s, I went to Wembley in the FA Trophy four times in 5 years. We won it three times, brilliant. We were perennial winners of the North Riding Senior Cup, the Northern Premier League Cup, runs in the FA Cup, the FA Trophy. It was just glorious. So we need to bring some of that. Ideally, what I'd like for this season to get the kids interested, a bit of a run in the FA Cup, the FA Trophy, because I think younger people can understand the cup competition better than the drudgery of a league campaign. So it's been a hard 10 years, but we're doing our best to be ready for the challenge of the next 10 and beyond. We don't underestimate our challenge for the next 10 years. We haven't got home. We can't rest on our laurels and take it easy. We've got to work even harder to maintain what we've got. The great news is, because we're back in town, local businesses are much more happy to get involved with us and give us some sponsorship, because they can see the benefit. Mm-hmm. We've got a great benefit, for example, selling ground boards, because it's not just for one match a fortnight. Because it's a community stadium and it's used 7 days a week for 12 hours a day, they're on show to the public all that time. So, yeah. Any questions? Oh.
Scarborough Athletic?
Yeah.
Have you thought of changing your name back to Scarborough FC?
We've thought about it. I can only give you my personal opinion. My personal opinion is, if we were to go back to Scarborough FC, it's disrespectful for all the people who worked 10 years to get us to where we are. We took the name Athletic because our old ground was the Athletic ground. I personally would like to keep it. There are some that would want to go back to Scarborough FC, but we're a new club, we're a different club, we operate differently, and my personal view is to keep the Athletic.
What I found very interesting is that all the challenges you've got there, everything you mentioned about getting back to Scarborough, it just everything that we discuss at our meetings about us getting back here, as quite right, we came back to New Boxing Day there,
yeah,
and the new challenges all start. It's similar but new challenges, and everything that you've mentioned in there just resonates with us. 100%.
Well, for 10 years of home games, we've rocked up on a Saturday, everything's been ready for us, and we just walk in, play a match, and then clear up again. Now it's up to us to get it ready and clear up afterwards and everything else, so it's very, very different. So I think most clubs that have gone through what we've been through, particularly, will recognise that as coming home is not the end of it, it's just a new beginning.
Yeah, the main thing that I took from that is when you said the lost generation, we discussed that ourselves, because we had 5 years, but 5 years of, you say, youngsters not getting on the bus because there's no buses back, especially for a night game. So therefore you've lost those children. And as you rightly said, you started at 9, I started at 5, and a lot of people, when I say about 12, 13, 14, you become of an age and you start going to games on your own with your mates.
You do.
Can't do that when you're travelling 20 miles out of town.
The length of time we've been away hits us in the face every time a group of us go to the match. Because one of my son-in-law's chums, who stands with us, his son was born on that day in 2007 that the new club was formed. He was born that very day. So every time we see Finlay, that's how old the club is. And he's going to be our mascot when we walk out for our first game. Okay.
So I've got a question.
All right.
Well, you hinted at some of the opportunities, actually. And just wondering if you got any other thoughts on that? Because for me, I'd imagine having the 3G pitch there with juniors coming to play suddenly.
It's massive. 3G is massive. I was very traditional. When I first heard about this going to 3G, I was like, oh no, we've got to have grass. But the fact that little Johnny can start playing at 9 years old and potentially play on that same pitch as playing for the first team, that's a big thing. So I know when I was that age, if I got a chance to play on Scarborough's pitch, oh, fantastic. So give them as many opportunities as you can.
Yeah.
We can start playing some of the schoolboy finals down there and all that sort of thing.
Yeah. And what about any of the other opportunities connected with the rest of the facilities? Is there
we've got
thoughts?
the facility is council-owned, but they've got a company called Everyone Active that manage it for them. We're linking in very strongly with them. They're our shirt sponsor for this last season and for next season. So we've got a good working partnership with them. And I guess there's some synergy around the sport that we love and people trying to keep fit. So, you know, we can work together on those sort of things as well.
Yeah.
And of course, it's great that whilst it's not ours, we've got a facility that we have reasonably easy access to in the form of the clubhouse that we can hold our club events as well. And we've been allowed to put some memorabilia up on the walls and that sort of thing. So you walk in, it does actually feel like it's our clubhouse, but it's only really our clubhouse for match day. But it's a nice feeling.
Yeah. And just one more question from me. The old ground, just interested to know what's going on there is. And have people been able to move on from that? Or
the Germans have taken over. it's now a little supermarket. At the front, housing where the shed used to be, and at the edge of the road end, there's more housing.
Yeah.
And sadly, when Lidl opened, I went round there with my wife to try and work out. I said, I think I'm where the pedals are. in some ways, now that's all been built, and Lidl's been built, that's gone. I've boxed that off. It was much more heartbreaking to walk past it and see the dereliction that was there.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that we have done is we have some metal gates on the front of the Scarborough Football Club. We've saved those, we've renovated them, we've integrated them into the new ground.
I've got quite a lot of stuff. My job in real life is an archaeologist, so I'm quite into old things, and I know the sort of like value of them really. And I realised 10 years ago, heartbreak it was, I just knew that somebody had to go in there and just save bits just in case for the future. The wife doesn't appreciate it. I've got two turnstiles, I've got sides, I've got soil, I've got seats, I've got everything. And carpet from the old bloody boardroom, I've got everything really so that we've got some bits of pieces to do with the past, because although we are a new football club, and we've got an identity as our own club now.
Yeah.
It is important because of Trevor's generation. Sorry, Trevor. Trevor's generation of the 70s.
You're not talking about the new archaeologist.
In the Paleolithic period of Trevor's era. It's important that if your club does go to the wall, and it unfortunately does, and if it does, it's important that you keep hold of those supporters as well as the new, because that's where Scarborough, there was a very difficult point when the old club went bust and belly up. There was a very, two supporters went in different directions, and it's really, really, but it's important for us now to try and get those back.
One of the key things that we may have got a new name, we may be a totally different club, but we see ourselves now as a continuation of that sort of thing. So, like with our opening game and our function that we've got on Saturday night, we've got all the old players from the old club. They're still our great, they're still our heroes. But interestingly, I've been asked, is that all the memorabilia you're putting up in the club? I said, absolutely. Because we're going to create our own history now. And that's what the space on the walls is for.
I'm not quite going to let you sit down. One more question, Joe. I'm just thinking, because it's a great point, some of the things Nick was saying about retaining, you know, waiting for this moment when it comes. There's obviously a lot of clubs we work with who be absolutely inspired, motivated by this story because they're in a similar situation at the moment. They're playing out of town. They need their own ground. So are there any particular things that stand out as saying absolutely make sure you have a relationship with these people, or anything that you can almost give them a sense of hope that you know what can keep them going? Because, you know, 10 years is a long time, isn't it? Yeah.
And there is a temptation when people that know nothing about football, and I've been in the business world for a lot of years, you start from the football club and your brain just disappears out your ear, and someone puts this load of mush in there and makes you all optimistic about everything, and the money's going to come in, and it's very easy to spend what you haven't got. So I would say be very clear about where you want to be in 10 years' time. Hopefully it isn't going to be 10 years, it was for us. We'll be very clear about what you want to be, where you want to be. Keep that focus, but keep a close eye on the finances. Because we nearly lost our club on at least two occasions. It really was that close. And when I've taken over, my first statement was that some of the fans might not like the fact I'm not going to buy that big striker from the West Riding, but I promised them that we won't be in debt. We've got to save the club for the future, because I personally felt that heartbreak in 2007. I don't want to go through that again.
Fantastic. So we've got, we've got one more.
The ground improvements that you mentioned, are you eligible for FSI?
We don't know all the details. I've got someone on the board that's used to bidding for all sorts of different things, so he's going to do that. Unfortunately, for the cover that I wanted to put behind the girl, that what we call the swimming pool then, we need to do that quite quickly, so there won't be time to get that in. But for the bigger projects further down the line, new seating. See, seating's another great one. I can't cover everybody. I can't sit anybody down because we've sold all the stand-up season tickets. So if someone comes in on a match day, oh, I need to sit down. Well, you can't. You're going to have to stand like not only can you can't sit down, we're going to have to stand then. If it rains, you're going to get wet through. It's not great, is it? Sometimes I'm not sure football clubs see the fans as customers. And you've got to treat your customers like, your fans like customers, because you've got to find ways of keeping them interested and keeping them coming back, because you're not always going to have a season where you win it up, you're not always going to have a season where you get promoted, but you've got to keep giving them reasons to shop with you, if you like, buy tickets.
Great. Well, I just personally like to say thank you very much, Trevor, and everyone at Scarborough. It's a fantastic story. I know there's an amazing amount of hard work, and it's all the sweeter to hear this story from Darlington, who have been through the same journey. So hopefully that gives some of our other members a bit of hope. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.